everyone, it's Micah. Welcome to our improvised lighting setup here as we go into part 3 of 3 of my reaction to the full Taylor's version of the album Red. Did I get all that right? Yes, I did. I apologize for the extended delay between reaction videos. Life has been hectic, and so I've been lagging a little behind my expected schedule. In between part 2, the reaction, which I released a couple weeks ago, and this reaction video, the Tortured Poets Department has come out. So now I have another album. Thankfully, in the discography of Taylor Swift to react to. I'm not going to jump ahead and react to that. We're going to go through, as intended, one album at a time. And we've made it up to Red, and we've made it up to part 3 of Red. And I've been warned about this song. This is track 21 off of Taylor's version. We're going to hit the last 10 tracks in this reaction video. And I've been warned about Ronan. I'm going to try to keep it together. Don't know exactly what to expect, but here goes.
I love you.
I'm lonely.
Yeah. I love you.
Get me as hard as some of the other songs that have the other tearjerkers on some of her other albums, but that's a pretty gut-wrenching song. It's really direct and straightforward. There's not a lot of attempt at poetry or reaching for lyrical depths or anything like that. This is an ode to this child, and there's something about the simplicity and the straightforwardness that I think is really affecting. But because it's just all laid bare in the song, there's not really anything that sort of twists the knife here. There's just the knife, you know. It's just obviously a painful, bittersweet, of course, because you know. The hook of the song is "You were my best 4 years." So there is a bittersweet call. Hey, Amir. Thanks for ruining the mood. Come on, buddy. Amir actually knocked over my whole setup in my last video, so I'm a little cautious. I'm gonna have to get a more sturdy setup for his purposes, but he'll be back, I'm sure. So it's definitely a bittersweet reminiscence, and it's very affecting in its own way. But for me, the songs that just really get me and gut me are the songs where the song is just going along, and all of a sudden there's a turn of phrase that really kind of really makes things go left from an emotional standpoint. And this song, it was, you know, there was no attempt to pull the rug out or do anything manipulative emotionally, other than, I mean, if you wanted to be cynical, you could say the entire song is that way. But there's no pretense here. This is just her talking in plain English about how she feels about the kid. The only question I guess I have is whether this song was intended to be a song from the perspective of the child's parent, or if it was her own personal ode to this child. I did not do any research to know exactly who Ronan was to her, but it almost sounds to me like she's taking on the voice of a parent rather than speaking personally, because it might read as a little presumptuous if she was inserting herself in the song as such a close confidant of this kid, but it's very possible she could have been. I don't really know what the dynamic was there. Delicately and tastefully done.
Probably better off on my own than loving a man who didn't know what he had when he had it. And I see the permanent damage you did to me. Never again, I just wish I could forget when it was magic. I wish it wasn't 4 a.m. standing in the mirror saying to myself, you know you had to. I know the bravest thing I ever did was
across the board on that one. I think that was probably one of the best songs on the entire album. And sometimes it's really just a song hits you at the right moment, maybe if I had listened to this 2 weeks ago, I would have been like, eh, it's okay. I don't know, but I was very receptive to what this song was giving me. And it really made me reflect on a lot of the stuff that's being said about Taylor in the media right now with the Tortured Poets Department. We're sort of back on this tired old trope of all Taylor ever does is complain about her old boyfriends, which I think is unfair, honestly. I think it is fair for people to say, I will not, you know, I am not a fan of this because to me it seems to retread the same territory. But that's one thing to say, and it's another thing to say that she's a bad artist or an inferior artist or not as good of an artist as X person over here because she keeps going to these themes. All artists gravitate toward certain themes, and most love songs gravitate toward this idea that you've done me wrong, especially stuff that comes out of a country tradition. This song, to me, seemed like probably the most country song. And there's been over 20 tracks at this point, so I could have forgotten something from my prior listens. But I think this, to me, sounds the most like a country song of anything that I've heard. And yes, there are country songs where people express regret for their own actions. But pretty much in country music and in popular music, it's pretty common for the person narrating the song to take a self-righteous stance. And this is kind of the ultimate non-ambiguous, you were wrong and I was right kind of lyric, because she's basically saying this relationship didn't work because you weren't good enough. So this is the epitome of that type of song from Taylor, but I'm so into it because she expresses in such a clear way what it was that she needed from the relationship. And that's the thing about Taylor's lyrics. They're not necessarily saying things that no one's ever expressed before, but they're saying them in a clear, concise way that causes you to get it from an emotional standpoint. It toes the line between cliche and esoteric. There are times when she goes out on a limb and says something that is a little, edgy's not the right word, but it's a little poetic, or a little twist of word, of phrase, I should say. Like, you pushed me away, I forget exactly how she put it, like, you pushed me away like I was a loaded gun. That's probably the coolest image in the song. And she goes to that point sometimes just to give you a sense of adventure, but she's really just expressing in a clear, concise way exactly how these things feel when you're in these positions. And most of us spend most of our time in relationships complaining about how the other person isn't good enough. This isn't something that Taylor invented when it comes to love songs. So I think holding her to task for making that type of song on a regular basis when basically everyone else in the world is sort of doing the same thing, it just seems more obvious with her because she's doing it in such a clear and concise way. Her lyrics are so front and center that you pay attention to them. There's people who've made entire careers out of bellyaching about all the ways that someone's broken their heart, and everyone just says, oh, they're such a great singer, or oh, they're such a great songwriter. But Taylor does it, and suddenly it needs to be called out. In a certain perverse way, it's almost like a testament to her songwriting that people keep paying attention every time she blasts someone for not being an optimal romantic partner. So anyway, that's my little spiel on that. But I thought this, the melody, the lyric, the vocal delivery, everything was top-notch here. I do not understand how this didn't make the cut, unless it just didn't fit in enough with the more pop-forward trajectory of this album. I don't know how it didn't make the cut. This to me should have been a single. It's one of my favorites that I've heard.
They tell you while you're young, girls go out and have your fun. Then they hunt and slay the ones who actually do it.
criticize the way you fly. When you're soaring through the sky, shoot you down and then they sigh and say, she looks like she's been through it. Lord, what will become of me once I've lost my novelty? I've had too much to drink tonight, and I know it's sad, but this is what I think about. And I wake up in the middle of the night. It's like I can feel time moving. How can a person know everything at 18 but nothing at 22? And will you still want me when I'm nothing new?
Album just getting better as it goes along, or am I just having a really receptive day right now? I don't know, maybe I'm just in a good mood for to hear new songs. That was great. It had a very unique texture, the way the song sounded, which is a noteworthy thing to say, because a lot of Taylor Swift songs sound very similar, because she's not going for audio innovation. She's generally going for good songwriting and coherent delivery of the lyrics that she wrote. But here, there's so much more going on. Those harmonies during the instrumental break of the song were just exquisite. And the way that the vocals were produced with that sort of hazy, dreamy kind of reverb effect or whatever that was really interesting. And also her vocal delivery during the verses was something that I don't recall hearing from her. It had a very breathy and intimate quality that almost reminds me of Billie Eilish, and I'm pretty sure at this point Billie had not made it onto the national scene when this came out. But I know Billie also has her influences, so maybe, I don't know if Lana Del Rey was out, and I don't know, and I'm really not very familiar with Lana Del Rey that much, but I do know that there's moodiness involved in a lot of the things that she sings. So I'm wondering whether this was a self-conscious attempt for her to step out and do something that was a little more innovative from the way the song sounds. But this is another really self-aware song. Some would call this self-indulgent navel gazing, but if you can't write songs about how you feel, then really what's the point? And that's the thing that keeps popping in my head whenever I hear criticisms. It's like, what is she supposed to write about? Is she supposed to write about what other people are thinking about? I mean, I guess the song from the last reaction that I did, I can't remember the name of it now. I'll put it up on the screen after as I'm editing. But there was one song that, was it Starlight? Anyway, the song where she was where someone informed me that she wrote the song after looking at a painting, I believe it was, and imagining how it would be to be in that situation, and she wrote a song around it. When she does stuff like that, I tend to be less engaged. Like, I want to hear what's on your mind. And if you're not interested in what an artist is thinking about, then why are you here? that's the thing that gets me about it. Like, what is it that they're supposed to be, what insight are you trying to get from any artist if you don't care what's going on in their head? Anyway, I'm on a little bit of a warpath today, I guess. I didn't come into this video thinking that's how this was going to come off, but I have aggressively enjoyed the last two songs, and to me, those are two of the strongest I've heard so far on here. What about your promises? What about your promises? What a shame. Didn't wanna be the one that got away, yeah. Big mistake. You broke the sweetest promise that you ever should. The space in the song, I liked the airiness, I liked the lack of lyrical density. It's a good change of pace. This is what Taylor was starting to really master, I think, with this album, the idea that she could let the song breathe and not necessarily fill it with imagery, not necessarily fill it with a bunch of cluttered thoughts that were running through her head. She's finding her way into this pocket where she's a pop star. Very much like at the time Katy Perry was a big pop star. This kind of, in a way, reminds me of a Katy Perry song. The production somewhat reminds me of some of the power pop kinds of things that were happening around this time. I really enjoy the sound of this song, and the lyrics were well tailored to the pop aesthetic. And of course, again, this album is about the heartbreak of being let down by someone, and so this is yet another song, another way of expressing that disappointment. And you really blew it, babe, and it's the last time I'll ever call you babe. Little small pun. It's both in a positive and a proper descriptor of what she's gonna not be calling him anymore. So I appreciated the small pun there as well. I know that you like me, and it's kind of frightening, standing here waiting, and I became hypnotized by freckles and bright eyes, tongue tied, but now she wanted to re-release this album, I would be itching to release all these unreleased tracks as well. This is phenomenal. Like, I am not pandering to the Swifties. If you've watched these videos, you know that if I'm not feeling a song, I will let you know. This back 10, these last 10 tracks are blowing me away. They are so good. Now, speaking of power pop, I mentioned the last song being kind of a power pop song, but this for real sounds like it could have easily been a Katy Perry song. And strangely enough, well, not really that strange, but then it struck me that if a guy were going to do this song, that I could totally hear Jason Derulo doing this song as well. It's just that hyper catchy, joyful dance pop sound, and she's killing it. Like, this is her first album where she's really trying to do anything of that nature. Not really understanding why this wasn't on the original album. Maybe it was too progressive from, or maybe too far of a leap from what people were used to hearing from her. I don't know, but that one is going on a playlist. Like, I don't say that often. Usually I can appreciate a song, but I'm not necessarily gonna crave going back and listening to it, but I really wanna hear that song again.
You had the sweetest eyes, the softest smile.
3 a.m. and I'm still awake. I'll bet you're just fine, fast asleep in your city. It's better than mine. And the girl in your bed has a fine pedigree. And I'll bet your friends tell you she's better than me.
Okay, well, I'm going to talk over the credits. I wasn't expecting a music video because none of the others in this YouTube sequence, they've all been lyric videos. And imagine my surprise, this was directed by Blake Lively. It's a funny and quite well done music video. The symbolism of the it's almost like the Billie Jean video. Everything she touches turns red, and that's kind of her. She kind of stains everything in a way, or she turns it red in conjunction with the album. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that this was maybe the promotional music video for when the re-release happened, because they certainly went all out on this. And again, this reminded me a whole lot of Speak Now, for obvious reasons. It's the video, although the song is not set at a wedding, the video is. And so it's this whole wedding crasher kind of fantasy scenario reliving itself again. And again, Taylor showing her petty side by saying, I really kind of want to taunt you and how you think you're in this wonderful new relationship. It's I think her transparency about how petty she can be really grounds these songs and makes it understandable that, or makes it more palatable, because Taylor's not saying she's in fact correct. She's saying, when I'm in this frame of mind to be this way, when I'm being this petty, of course these are the thoughts that come into my mind. She's literally taunting him in the song, and the guy in the song, and she's also taunting him by talking about his upper class status and his elitism. And by this time in her career, in 2012, she had been a superstar for 6 years, but she manages to make it believable. Like, even though you're still rooting for her as the down-home gal that she's making herself out to be, although it requires some suspension of disbelief. But again, this is about how she feels, and in her mind, she's still that same person. Her self-concept is what is, I hate saying this phrase, but it is what it is. Her self-concept rest on certain assumptions, and several of her songs have pitted her against the new love that the man selected over her, and in many cases takes this sort of I wasn't good enough for you type of attitude. But the truth is, so many of us can relate to a situation like that, and it's that empathy that really drives the engagement in the song. I thought the video was hilarious and in some ways it's almost poignant and fantastic. And the song is not too shabby either. I enjoyed the harmonies. I was looking forward to maybe an actual duet with Chris Stapleton, but he's actually just providing background vocals on the song. I was eager to hear him come in on the second verse and give the other side of the story, but that's not how the song was set up.
Doesn't believe anything much he hears these days. He says, why fall in love just so you can watch it go away? He spends most of his nights wishing it was how it used to be. He spends most of his flights getting pulled down by gravity. I call just checking up on him. He's up 3 a.m. pacing. He says, it's not just a phase. believe in one thing, I won't go away.
It's nice to hear Taylor give an unconditional plea to preserve a relationship. And ultimately, I think that's the key to listening to just about anybody's music. Songs are snapshots of how we're feeling at different times. Sometimes you feel like, go on, get out of here, get out of my life. And sometimes you feel like, please don't go. And they're not contradictory, because there are phases that we go through in a relationship. Whatever is true in one moment may not be true in the next moment. And this is a moment in a relationship when she feels like it's all or nothing. When either I stay and accept you no matter what, or it's forever winter. It's a pretty stark ultimatum. But in certain times in relationships, we feel that way. We don't feel like there's any alternative. We feel like it's either this person or bust. And this is not necessarily my favorite that I've heard this listen, but it's still a solid track. The soaring melody, I think, is the strongest part. And I like the way she's experimenting with different cadences. I just like that she was playing with those lyrical tempos. The instrumental choices, the arrangement was also different from what I've heard in other songs. So I liked that she's experimenting with some things here. But overall, not my absolute favorite that I've listened to this time, but still a solid track.
Shouldn't be in this town. And my so-called friends, they don't know I'd drive away before I let you go. So give me a reason, don't say no, no. There's a chain round your throat, piece of paper where I wrote, I'll wait for you. There's a key on the chain, there's a picture in a frame. Take it with you and run like you've run from the law. Darling, let's run, run from it all. We can go where eyes can take us. Like a child, and I sing like no one cares. No one to be, no one to tell. There's been this hole in my heart. This thing was a shot in the dark. Say you'll never let them tear us apart.
Different to kind of getting into it to really, really getting into it. This song is one that just kind of envelops you as you go along. It's simple, and I enjoyed the casual lyricism. With Taylor Swift, you can usually hear her wheels turning as she's trying to construct the cleverest and most concise possible lyrics. But the lyrics on this song sound have a different quality to them. Just even in the chorus, when you think you would want the snappiest lyric, they end up saying run like we're running from the law, which is a pretty pedestrian lyric. But I think it's intentional. I think the whole idea of the song is that it's almost like a campfire type of song where you are more or less free associating, and not trying to be the most clever, not trying to be the most pithy. It's a very relaxed kind of lyric, and it does sound to me more like an Ed Sheeran lyric than Taylor Swift. I'm going to look after the video and see if I'm guessing correctly here, but this sounds more like an Ed Sheeran song to me than it does Taylor Swift. But I also think I have this phantom awareness of co-writers or who wrote the song, and typically if I see another person on the song, I automatically get suspicious that maybe that person was the one who wrote this particular track. So it's happened a couple of times and I've been fooled. But we'll see. I'm gonna check. I'm not in any position right now to like do the research live as we're listening. But I enjoyed that track. It was quite hypnotic, and the lyric video was also, I think, playing a role in making it very hypnotic, because it was, of course, a slow motion drive down a country road. I was in particular reminded of Ed's song Castle on the Hill, because that, and again, I think it's the casual lyricism of the song. There's a dreaminess, I think, to the way the song is presented that reminds me of Castle on the Hill.
In time, I'd write this in the sky. I miss you like it was the very first night. And so it goes, every weekend the same party. I never go alone, and I don't seem brokenhearted. My friends all say they know everything I'm going through. I drive down different roads, but they all lead back to you.
Cute, catchy little song. Definitely not my favorite from this album, and not my favorite from this session. This is the closest I've heard in a while to a song that sounds kind of phoned in. There's nothing really to distinguish it from a lyrical standpoint. I did notice here, and I have noticed in other songs, that she really likes the imagery of flying. In all kinds of contexts, she uses the imagery of flying. She also likes documenting what time it was when things happened. She didn't do that, but she does talk about going back in time. So I think she has a preoccupation with flying and a preoccupation with time that keeps showing up in her lyrics, whether it's naming a specific time when something happened, or talking about how old she is at a particular point compared to how she was at another point in the song. I mean, there's a song, obviously, 22 on this album, and there's certainly motifs that I know that I am not going to uncover for the first time for Taylor Swift fans, but it's just interesting to note. I'm just letting you know I see those things. But other than just kind of seeing a lot of Taylor Swift-isms in the song, there's not really too much for me to observe here. It's kind of a catchy, fun-loving song about being in love or recapturing the feeling from when you first met somebody. Not anything particularly special. I feel like a lot of the melodies, different melodic components here were recycled from earlier songs. It reminded me a little bit of Love Story. It just felt very familiar to me. It felt like a bit of a retread of a lot of other songs that she's released before. So not bad, just not groundbreaking. And that leads us to the last song on Taylor's version of Red, and that is the 10-minute version of All Too Well. I don't think I've heard all 10 minutes of this, but I was certainly aware of it. It went number one, I believe, in 21 when it came out. It was a big deal. It revived a certain antipathy towards the ex that she was allegedly talking about.
I don't know, I just feel like maybe I made you up.
Twin flame, whose paint you blue. Just
There you have it. That was the last track off of the Taylor's version of Red. I wasn't expecting, well, I didn't even know about the short film. I'm sure I heard something about it at the time, but it apparently fell out of my head. I was pretty impressed with the short film. I think it's worth noting that when other artists do these short film video productions of their songs, typically they are flashy, full of effects, full of cameos, full of pyrotechnics, and all, you know, full of a lot of flash. It's sort of almost the reason why you do that in the first place, is to, you know, it's a kind of a big tentpole, attention grab, promotional type of thing to do. And I'm not saying that Taylor's the first version to adapt that format for a more intimate story, but it's the only one I can think of off the top of my head. Like, for you to do an entire 14-minute short film and it not be full of flashiness and special effects and dance routines and all this other stuff. This is a very different kind of short film from what I'm used to seeing when artists really go all out and do that type of thing. So I appreciate her sticking her neck out and directing and writing this this screenplay, as it were, for this short film. As for the song itself, I guess I thought that what happened was that Taylor originally wrote a bunch of extra verses for the song, and then on the Taylor's version, she just released all the extra verses. But what it sounds like, and I may be wrong about this, but what it sounds like is that she revisited the song and added lyrics, especially that last piece, which sounds like it's in retrospect years later, even though the video is also coaxing you toward that as well. But I think the lyrics made reference to it then. The song would have been too fresh at the time she originally wrote it for that last verse to really make sense. So it actually sounds more like she added different lyrics, not in the same cadence as the original verses. They don't even have the same tone as the original verses. It's a much more direct and dramatic lyrical cadence that she's using. It's almost like she layered a song on top of another song. So it's got a great kind of dynamic to it. It's not herky-jerky operatic things like Bohemian Rhapsody, but it does cause the mood to shift from one movement in one section of the song to the other in a clear way, not an ostentatious way, but a very clear progression through the different ways that she processed this relationship. So I was expected, honestly, to be a little bored with a 10-minute song, but that variation, the whole idea of layering one type of verse or lyric structure on top of another, it worked really well, and it's not something that I can say I've heard in a song before. So I'm kind of impressed in a way I wasn't expecting to be by this 10-minute version of the song. I will say that during the break in the music in the middle, that argument that she was having about being ignored in a social situation, I felt that really deeply, because I've had that conversation before. I tend to be kind of a wallflower, so I've definitely had that conversation with someone before, and it is really hurtful when you kind of feel like I need you to throw me a lifeline here in this social situation, but you're really wrapped up in enjoying it yourself, which I don't want to begrudge you, but I am floundering over here. And so I really felt that conversation, and it really resonates with me as something that I've been through myself. And so overall, just, yeah, I was way more impressed with that than I expected to be. And as a whole, I was way more impressed with the additional tracks on this album than I was expecting to be. You really do think that the filler tracks on an album are really going to be of a lesser quality, but I can't really tell the difference between the original tracks and in terms of quality, certainly not in my enjoyment of the tracks, between the original tracks from 2012 and the tracks that were released for the first time in 2021. I thought that was great. So overall, just really, it's really exciting to listen to this progression, and we're going to be listening to 1989 next, which is the album where I really, really started paying attention to Taylor Swift, and I'm excited to hear that one in its entirety for the first time, and also to hear all the wonderful bonus tracks, because now I know what I'm in for, more really high quality stuff. I apologize for taking so long to get this third part of the reaction out, but it's here now. Please like the video if you indeed liked it. Please subscribe to the channel if you feel so inclined, and if you're a Taylor Swift fan, you really should, because I've got a lot more albums to react to, including now the Tortured Poets Department. And finally, please help me to make music better.